Knightline is brought to you by the Dever Team, your source for New Smyrna Beach real estate and everything else New Smyrna Beach. Go to www.thedeverteam.com and call UCF alumni Travis Dever for all your New Smyrna Beach needs. 386-690-1636. That's 386-690-1636.
Welcome to UCF Nightline, your source for UCF sports and former player information.
Hello, Night Nation. This is Andrew Phegley coming to you from the 1148 studios, and this is Nightline 180 from the award-winning Nightline Sports Network. Joining me as always,
Trace Trylko. Hello, everyone. Our position-by-position reviews continue. Taking a look at the offensive line, we're talking recruiting with UCFSports.com publisher Brandon Helwig. We hear from some former Knights who helped the Apollos lift off with a win. Hoops insider Ben Stout on UCF getting the road dub, and what makes the cows so awful? That's an Ask Nightline. But first,
dum-de-dum-de-dum, dum-de-dum.
You there!
You guys, Smiley!
Yes, I am, and you're the next contestant on the waiting game!
Oh, boy, the waiting game!
Yes,
imagine
yes.
Me luck! Me get to play waiting game! Oh, boy, what waiting game?
Well, the game where we give you a cookie!
Love this game! Mm-hmm. Cookie!
Wait!
Whoa, why me? Why wait?
Because this is the waiting game!
All right, well, Cookie Monster and Guy Smiley from Sesame Street. Well, we're playing a waiting game for sure, as we have to wait until the end of August for UCF football to return.
That's quite the segue there. Well, Guy Smiley.
Guy Smiley, yeah, he was awesome.
He's angling for a position on Nightline.
I'm a big fan of Sesame Street, by the way, back in the day. I watched that a lot when I was a kid. So, and you might hear something more about this later on in this episode.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah.
Well, it is a waiting game, but every day it gets closer to. Now we know opponents and dates, kind of, sort of.
Yeah.
Dates. We've got a schedule, and things are getting closer.
All except for that first game. We know when our games are going to be. We can make our travel schedules or our calling out of work.
What do you
whatever.
Think? What's your reaction?
I mean, I think it's good. I don't know about these weeknight games. I mean, Friday night games are fine for me. Thursday night games kind of suck personally. But I would like to see that
home opener with FAMU end up on a Saturday night.
I would too. So
I've got some conflicts. I can't
either
rearrange.
It could be Thursday, August 29th or Saturday, August 31st. So I'm bummed that we don't have 7 home games. We knew that,
but
I'm still bummed about it. I really like
well
having
that
7
game
home
at Florida Atlantic though for a good bit of our fan base. It's drivable from Central Florida. We've got a big alumni base in South Florida and South Central Florida. So is that the one we've talked about circling for the Nightline road trip?
Possibly. I'm planning on. I'd like to really go to Tulane. This year as well. So
wow.
I that's the one that I was planning on going to was Tulane. Just to go to New Orleans. You know, go up a day early or whatever and hang out in New Orleans. So that was mine. But we could make it the Florida Atlantic as well.
As I look at that game, it does seem like a question we got on Ask Nightline recently about which game would be hurricaned out. And I'm guessing that one would be the one, the Florida Atlantic one.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it just fits
Tulane,
right in that game.
Yeah,
not Tulane.
Well, at the end of November, I don't think. Yeah, that one could be the one, obviously.
Of course, it would be Stanford, because
right.
That would be the premier home game.
And that would
get
be
dashed
the one
from the
that,
schedule.
Right, that we would need for our strength of
yeah,
schedule and
one.
All that. But we were planning on going to North Carolina last year, so I think Tulane is the one this year, even though it's right around the holiday-ish time.
Tulane is last road game, and it's back-to-back road games, but there's a bye in there, because that's a Friday, November 8th. They're scheduled at Tulsa, Saturday, November 23, at Tulane. So they get back-to-back road games there before the Cows are here on Black Friday.
That's where our bye week is.
Well, there's one bye there, and you see as well a pretty tough game Friday, October 4 at Cincinnati, and then a bye before welcoming ECU.
Right.
The schedule set up where if you just listen to it like this, it's home, road, home, road, home, road, home, road, home, road, road, home.
Yeah.
So remember there were some issues with we'd have three straight games and there was a little bit of fatigue on the fan base. If you're traveling from all points across the state to get here and it's maybe a Friday night game and then you're back on Saturday. So there was some of that. Here it's spaced out and they don't have the
Houston and Tulsa back on the schedule.
Yeah. So we rotate off Memphis. No more Memphis for a while.
Yeah. Who else do we rotate? There's somebody else that we rotate
SMU.
Off. Oh, yeah, SMU.
And
yeah.
Navy.
Yeah.
And so we end up with Houston, Tulsa and Tulane. And those, as it turns out, those are the three straight games there in November.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously the Houston game will be a good game because I think their quarterback should be back. So,
all right. So do it right now. Go through. Just give me win, loss, win, loss, win, loss. No deep thinking. Just just your initial reaction. People be driving on the treadmill, and they're going to listen and agree or disagree.
So I'm going to say win. Florida Atlantic.
Florida A&M.
Oh, Florida A&M. Yeah, I forgot that one's first. I just wasn't even looking at that one. Yeah. So win.
Stanford.
Yeah. Pittsburgh, I'm going to say we probably win that game as well. UConn, I don't know. I mean, you know, no, we'll win that one. Cincinnati could be a difficult one. I think they're going to be a little bit better this year.
Is that a win or a loss?
I don't really see any game on here that we can't win. If everything goes as planned, I picked last year to have one loss.
Right,
you did. And I was wrong. So
by one.
By one.
Yes.
well, it was easy. I don't see a game on this schedule that we can't win. We have, you know, the most difficult games, except for the Pittsburgh game, are at home.
ECU, you got to win at Temple?
Except at Cincinnati. I don't think Temple's going to be that bad. Do they even have a head coach?
They do now.
I mean,
But that was a tough game in Orlando. Primetime showcase last year.
Cincinnati or Temple?
Well, both.
Okay. Well, Temple, I mean, coaching change.
Yeah.
Cincinnati, did they keep their coach?
Yes.
Okay.
Luke Fickell.
Yeah. See, that's the game that, as far as conference game that worries me, is that game.
Houston?
That's the only one.
Houston
is at home. They've had some issues as well, right? Coaching. Well, did they have a coaching change or... Definitely coordinator changes, because their offensive coordinator is now at Florida State. I know that. So,
and of course, their quarterback was injured.
Quarterback was injured. Tore his ACL, I think.
Houston's got the new coach, Dana Holgerson, from West Virginia.
Oh yeah,
that's right.
Yeah. So I'm not worried about that as much because I don't think he's going to be able to step in and just. Make it. And then Tulsa, I'm not worried about that. Tulane plays a high-powered, fast offense, and I think that their whole deal is kept together. So our defenses obviously will be used to playing that, so I don't think it's going to be huge, but I think they could give us a little bit of a run. And then South Florida at the Bounce House, which is going to be awesome if it turns out where we're both good or something. There's not one game on here that I'm going to call a loss right now.
All right, so I asked on Twitter, how many games will UCF win in 2019? 4% said 9 or, I think I phrased it, 9 or fewer, 4%. Mm. 10 wins, 28%. 11 wins, 30%. 12 wins, 38%.
Well,
I don't share your level of optimism at this point, only because I think it is very... We don't know what we're getting at the quarterback position.
I don't think it matters.
I think it does. I'm not to a point where I want to predict wins and losses. I'd say Stanford's formidable just because it's Stanford. Pittsburgh is a road game. I'd consider a challenge. Cincinnati, I think, is a challenge.
Where did Stanford end up last year?
In a bowl game, but I don't know that they were anything more than like an 8-4 or a 7-6 or something along those lines.
Not the Stanford as the last Stanford that we played. Mm-mm. No.
No, I don't think they were that type of team.
That could be a difficult game, even at home. That could be, for sure. But I don't think that they're...
I don't think 9-3 is out of question. With we don't know what we're getting at quarterback. That's all. I have confidence in Daryl Mack, and I like Brandon.
We've got a lot of options at quarterback. There's a lot of options.
But that option is probably not one Mackenzie Milton. And no. I go into that season, I think going into this past season, thinking I had us for two losses. Happy to be wrong. And that was with Mackenzie Milton.
I got to meet Dylan Gabriel the other night, by the way. And I talked to Mackenzie.
Ah.
So that was cool. The basketball game the other day. I got out of the elevator going up to the loge, and Dylan Gabriel was standing right there, like, you know, when the door opened. And I'm like, hey, what's up, dude?
What's his height in comparison to Mackenzie?
About similar? The same. Similar? Yeah, they're about the same. I mean, they're almost identical players. Mm. They are. I mean, I think that that's what's... I'm not worried about that. We've got Wimbush, we've got Mack, and we've got Gabriel. Any one of those guys could do it.
So it does seem like, again, these Twitter polls are not scientific, of course, but no. Pretty fairly, you know, between 10, 11, and 12 got the bulk of it almost in equal measure. So majority of the fan base responding thinks it's 10, 11, or 12 wins versus anything less. I just think there's some questions. I don't think we're going to know what we get until we get to the games, obviously. I'm just saying to you that I have a lesser confidence going into this season without McKenzie at quarterback. And I went into this past season seeing two losses on the schedule with a McKenzie at quarterback. So it's hard for me not to.
And you were wrong.
Happy to be wrong. Happy to be wrong.
Both wrong.
And those were Memphis. I thought they'd lose at Memphis, and darn near almost did.
Yeah, and that was the one I thought. And you thought we would lose to Pittsburgh. Yeah.
Pittsburgh. And that was, you know, they dominated Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
So, I
feel we're going to do the same thing to Pittsburgh.
And then I think there's some questions on, obviously, on defense. That a lot of things have gone right for this team and through their own efforts, certainly. But, you know, the ball bounces the right way. You get the right thing happens. And, you know, in years past, those breaks didn't always go UCF's way. And then you find yourself on the losing end of a close game. And you saw how tight that game was at Memphis. Could have gone, I mean, you know, tremendous 4th-and-1 call. And there were some big plays. But that was shaping up to be a loss in the regular season on the road. So,
yeah, it was the absolute worst our team had played in 2 years, though.
I guess at the end of the day,
the absolute worst that they had played. They weren't in that game. Their minds and their brains were not in that game. They did not show up until the second half.
I guess at the end of the day, it's hard for me to picture and go starting another 25 game.
I think we're going to start another streak, to be honest with you. And I think that that kind of a streak thing is going to become commonplace here. Personally, I think
mark
that
it down. Knightline 180. We'll pull that out of the archives.
I was the only one, I think, to predict that we would do it the last time that we did it.
You predicted we go on 25.
No, I predicted that we would go 13-0 the year before, though, the 17 year.
I don't remember this prediction.
Go back and listen.
You're wrong on all your predictions.
No, go back and listen. Go back and listen.
I'll have to find that episode.
Okay. Anyway, yes, I did. And even one of our listeners pointed it out because I forgot about it. But anyway,
oh, that's right. Somebody did point it out.
Because I forgot about it. Because I said exactly the same thing I just said, as I didn't think that any of those games that we couldn't win. And I think another part of that and another reason that I'm saying that is that Heupel is in his second year. The entire staff is complete with the same people. There's no reason with the talent that we have from the best recruiting class, personally, that we've ever had, that we can't do it again and we can't start a fresh streak, personally. Mm-hmm. I just what I think. I could be wrong.
Book it.
I've been wrong before. Hopefully I'm not wrong this time.
Mark it down.
Yep.
Well, what will contribute to that, obviously, is replenishing and the strength on the offensive line. And
great recruiting.
And we talked to Brandon Helwig about recruiting. You know, Heupel came in after Frost left, and then that was the early signing period, the first year of that. I mean, he scrambled to get together guys, and then, you know, has January, you know, as he's trying to put together. This is his first full year on the job. And so what they recruited in December and here with the national signing day in February is really the type of player he wants and that his coaching staff wants. I'm not dismissing the other guys, but they just had so little time to prepare. He's hiring coaches, he's moving. I mean, all these things are going on. This is a guy who's established now, and you point out right there, you know, there's some names that get floated. It's a sign of progress for a program when your coaches are being wooed to go other places. Mm-hmm. And they all stay.
Yep.
And that continuity is good for the chemistry of the team and for the, you know, the players.
And the biggest one besides Heupel not going anywhere was Jeff Lebby not going anywhere. He is a huge part of what's going on here. And I don't think people realize. I've had to explain that to people just because it's not totally common knowledge of what he actually does. So that's huge for him to stay. And it's huge for everybody to stay. And I just think that that's going to really give confidence for players and confidence for coaching staff, confidence for Josh Heupel going into his second year and knowing what he's doing now. I mean, last year, really, I mean, he didn't know what he was doing as a head coach. First year ever. And he stepped into the hardest job possible to step into.
Unbelievable expectations.
Yeah. And he did it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I just don't expect him to, like, lose a team. I don't expect, after coming in and handling that, for him not to be able to handle it. So,
well, as our position-by-position reviews continue, and we did a little foreshadowing on this last week, we had Tyler Hudanik on, mm-hmm. who I loved listening to the interview and thinking back 4 years on Knightline when he first joined. He's one of the departures on the offensive line, Wyatt Miller, who was just on with Adam and Mike on the Sons of UCF, an entertaining interview. If you haven't heard it, go back in and listen
to it.
They're
doing a great job.
And Tyler Hudanik mentioned something in his conversation with you that seemingly indicates that where we were concerned.
And I heard it. I just did not react to it because it kind of sounded like he wasn't sure. So I wanted other people to pick up on that and start talking about it, and that's what happened, thank goodness. And then it was confirmed a little while later. So let's play that clip here real quick.
Jake Brown, I think, is coming back or is back, so that'll be huge.
So there it was.
It was, what, 4 seconds?
Yeah, it wasn't very long. It was 3 seconds,
Tyler
actually.
Hudanik breaking some news there.
Yeah.
That's huge, though.
It is big. It's big.
That's huge. So, again, while you lose Tyler and Wyatt, you're talking about an offensive line that returns Jordan Johnson and Jake Brown, and then we saw what Cole Schneider can do.
All-American, freshman All-American, big deal. Big, big deal.
And then, of course, you have Parker Boudreau, Trevor Albert, Josh McMullen, and again, they've been recruiting. That was a big focus in the first year on the offensive line.
If you look at what Josh Heupel is trying to do here, and I think that, well, I was talking with this about this with somebody. Josh Heupel is trying, and I remember saying this before when we started looking at the recruiting classes. Josh Heupel is trying to build an offensive and defensive line SEC capable to play with anybody in the country, and that those foundations will be absolutely huge for this team and going forward for years to come if he builds what he wants to build with these guys. And if they're a little different, like I've said, they're not as, you know, they're not the downfield guys as much, but they're
again,
run
that's
blockers.
The contrast you've made with the, and I remember you talking a lot when Frost was here of the type of guys that he was getting. You're starting to see that contrast.
It's a different thing. He wants to open the wide holes for the running backs to run through. I mean, that's, you know, and just have a solid pass block. And, you know, I mean, the running game is so huge. Obviously, we saw this year with Greg McRae. He has to, the bigger the hole he has, the better it is. Downfield, downhill running. And, I mean, honestly, the type of guys that he's recruiting, if he can get all those guys on board, of course, there's going to be a couple that fall out that, you know, don't turn out to be what they're supposed to be or whatever. But I'm so excited for this offensive and defensive line men that he's getting, because they're going to be unstoppable. They will be unstoppable once they're firing on all cylinders. And I'm so excited about it. Because you're going to see, I think you're going to see a 1,000-yard rusher over and over and over again. I mean, it's going to be a big, big deal if he can keep that whole core together and keep getting bigger and better guys. I'm excited about it.
And we really saw over the course of the season, the right word I feel is the emergence of Greg McRae. We didn't see Greg McRae in that first game of the season be the Greg McRae a couple of games in that was starting
to. Know who it was going
to
be.
But we started seeing big rushing totals from Greg McRae. I picture Greg McRae with 12 games. Mm-hmm. And,
absolutely.
You know, I mean, that's so
I mean, he is absolutely, I mean, I do not like worry about saying this at all. He is one of the top 10 running backs in the entire United States, and the entire college football. I'm telling you.
So as we kind of put a bow on the offensive line, and I think we'll have opportunity as camp opens to have this conversation more, and certainly leading up to the spring game, April 13th, a couple of questions for you. What are you looking for out of camp? Maybe Heupel will tell you, probably won't. But for me, one is, where are we at in that quarterback competition? Because Coach Heupel talked about it during his press conference this week. Nobody's guaranteed a job. You got to go out and earn it. For me, that's one. I think that's going to remain both a spring and fall camp question that we're not really going to know how it settles until they start playing games. Though I would say here, I think we see Brandon Wimbush, Daryl Mack in some capacity. I don't think it's one guy and the other guy sees no play.
By committee, which I hate to do. But,
well, no, I'm not even saying but I think there are roles in the offense for whichever one may not earn the starting job.
Yeah.
I'd like to see different, better use in terms of Otis Anderson and maybe even Adrian Killens than what we saw in this just completed season. I think there's more opportunity, more upside potential for both of those guys.
There is, but I'm not counting on either one of those guys to be the stars anymore. I'm just not. I mean,
well, stars in what capacity? Is stars as the
neither
everyday
one
back
of them,
or in other
neither
capacities?
One of them are going to run for the yards that Greg McRae is. Definitely.
No, I would say that. I'd agree with that.
So, I mean, I think they've learned their lesson, hopefully, with running Adrian Killens up the middle. It doesn't work.
Yeah, it's not worked.
So if they want to use him in a slot position or something, the little guys, one of those guys should be, Otis Anderson struggled at times returning punts and kicks. I think that that's probably where they're most suited to do the most, except if they use him in a slot position. And they need to use him a little bit more, but they're not the type of running back that Heupel's looking for. They're not. They were just the guys that were here.
So as you look at the offensive line then, your question or something you want to see that maybe gets clarified a little bit more in spring with that group, knowing again that they have to replace Wyatt Miller and Tyler Hrdanek. But
I just
want to
see who the new guys are. If we get another, maybe a grad transfer or something, who fills in those two spots? Who steps up that, you know, wasn't here as a new, you know, a freshman that maybe can step in there, or somebody that is sitting there that we haven't seen much of. I just want to see who fills those spots. That's what I'm looking for.
And we'll be able
they
to
all
talk.
Have to rotate.
Yeah.
That's the thing. You have to keep those guys fresh.
Yeah.
So if you look at the pure numbers that he's recruiting in these spots, it's to keep all these guys fresh. I mean, if you looked at it, I mean, they rotated in and out mm-hmm. all the time. And the more guys, the more guys that are equal that can do that, the better you're going to be.
Well, not only is that giving guy a rest, but it's getting another guy reps.
Well, yeah,
and experience.
It's all about keeping them fresh, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So where do you want to go next week? Defensive line, as we move off of the offense, is a good contrast to the offensive line. Shift
sure.
over and start
yeah.
talking.
Yeah.
Because we'll have a couple more weeks before the this.
And I think that we'll, we'll revisit
opens.
All this stuff
yeah.
at some point, because it's not, you know, this is really early to be doing this stuff. But we'll look at it.
It's the waiting game.
No, I know.
As referenced by...
Well, the waiting game has gotten a little bit easier this year because of this whole Apollos thing. And I don't know where we were going to talk about this.
A little later on.
A little later. But but the waiting game is a little bit easier because of it.
Well, I mean, look at the football notes you just mentioned.
I mean, we're watching live football.
Yeah, live football.
February 10th. We're watching live football, and it's not the Canadian League.
No. That's our usual pastime, watching Canadian football.
And then that'll come. It hasn't even started yet. But we're watching live football.
So take a look at these news and notes. You just mentioned Greg McRae. That's a pretty good honor, that one right there.
Yeah, Touchdown Club of Columbus recognizes junior safety Richie Grant and junior running back Greg McRae as players to watch in 2019. I think they're more than players to watch, personally.
That's probably an understatement. Yeah. They were probably like, really? You needed, yeah.
Yeah.
Really?
We knew that.
Did you see the picture posted on social media?
They spiff little up pretty good, don't they? Stuff,
well, you normally see them in street clothes or you see them in football pads. So when you see them all dressed up, suit and tie, it's...
Yeah, and then Tristan Hill got a combine invite, the only one, which is kind of interesting. I thought maybe there would be a couple more.
Where do you see him going? See him in the seven rounds there?
I don't know. His work ethic is gonna hurt him, personally. And that's what hurt him here. And that's why he's moving on. His work ethic is gonna hurt him.
A lot of talent, though.
A lot of talent. Yeah. He just has to figure out how to use it. Somebody has to get in between the eyebrows with him and figure out what he needs to be successful. I think that's gonna be... He has all the talent in the world. He just has to figure out. Somebody has to get it out of him. And, you know, obviously it wasn't going to happen here, and he knew that. So,
well, we're another week closer.
But that's going to – I think that will determine where he goes and when he goes. I think stuff like that, they pay attention to things like this. They do a lot of psychological testing on these guys, and we'll see how that works out for him.
Yeah,
so
another week closer then to spring camp opening. I mean, I know it's February, but we'll have spring camp in March.
I know
the spring game
there.
April 13th.
We're getting there, and you know, there's live football until the end of April.
We got the Alliance League
till the end of April
to carry us through.
It's exciting.
Nightline, your source for the best UCF conversation, continues in just a moment. We welcome back Brandon Helwig from UCFSports.com. He's talking about the new football recruiting class. Stay with us.
Hey, this is Travis Dever, Kai's Real Estate, the Dever Team, New Smyrna Beach. Your source for real estate and everything else New Smyrna Beach. Proud sponsor of Knightline and Knightline Post Game Live. Call me anytime at 386-690-1636. That's 386-690-1636. Let me show you my hometown, New Smyrna Beach, UCF's favorite beach. Go Knights and charge on.
Excited about what we did on both sides of the line of scrimmage, offensive and defensive line. I think everyone here knows that with us coming in, that was a point of emphasis for us. We lost a bunch of really good football players on the defensive line, and having to replace those guys was a high priority for us in this recruiting class. I'm proud of what our entire staff did. Coach Burnham going out and getting some really good players, I think, will help us next fall. And help us long-term there at that position as well. I think the speed that we added at the skill spots, in particular at wide receiver, is something that, again, we're trying to continue to add to our roster.
Well, that was the clip of Josh Heupel talking about National Signing Day, the last part, National Signing Day Part 2.
Part 2. Couple of guys.
And that was him wrapping it up, basically, in the press conference that he had. I loved it at the beginning. I don't know if you saw this thing live. You weren't there, I know that. But he came out and he's like, hey, it's been a long time. That was the first thing he said to everybody. I don't know if they showed that on everything. But it was good to hear Josh Heupel talk again in front of the media. And it brings football season even that much closer because of that.
And again, as we get into with Brandon, by all accounts, UCF considered pretty much cream of the crop in the American in recruiting, and as well amongst the group of five. I'm not trying to get into a hole, not calling them the Power Six. I'm just saying of these conferences.
Whatever. It is what it
is. You know, upper 40s, some places I've seen 49, I've seen 50, 51, 52, 53, but that gives you a range to what extent that matters.
Well, we were the top in both of those, so, yeah. I mean, that's what is really important. And right there, he talked about exactly what we were talking about just a little while ago, about the offense and defensive lines being extremely important. But we can get more analysis by talking to Brandon Helwig.
The Knights ink a few more guys on National Signing Day. Let's talk about the new recruits with a return guest on Knightline, Brandon Helwig, publisher at UCFSports.com. He joins us now on the Knightline Hotline. And Brandon, the first line of your article reads, "The hoopla of February's National Signing Day is now officially a thing of the past." Feels like that entire event moved to December.
It has. I mean, you know, last year was the first year of the new rules, which enacted an early signing day. And, you know, because UCF was going through a coaching change, going from Scott Frost to Josh Heupel, you know, we didn't really get the full effect of it just because, you know, that time period was trying to hang on to many of the Frost recruits. And then, you know, there were more spaces available, you know, to go and find guys during the month of January to sign in February. But when there's been no coaching change, even, you know, for the most part, UCF signed pretty much all their class back in December. And, you know, that's a wild month, too. I mean, football season's going on. You know, it seems like, you know, you just play the conference championship game, and before you know it, it's that signing day, so it just comes really fast. And at that time, you know, everyone's talking about Fiesta Bowl and getting out to Arizona and playing LSU. So it kind of gets lost in the shuffle a little bit. I mean, you know, obviously we talked about it and covered everything then, but, you know, I understand why they made the rule changes. I'm sure if you're a college coach, you like the, you know, signing guys that have been committed for a long time, signing them a little bit earlier so you don't have to stress out about them during the month of January. But it kind of was maybe better from, you know, a media coverage kind of fan interest standpoint when you kind of look at the months, like the 12 months of college football, so to speak. You've got your regulars, you know, beginning in August, you've got preseason, you've got regular season, you know, September, October, November, you know, December is going to be your bowl game. A little bit of recruiting sometimes gets going in December when you've got, you know, official visits maybe. And then the month of January is just recruiting, recruiting, recruiting usually. Got a lot going on. You've got guys visiting every weekend. You got people committing, decommitting, what have you. And then, you know, first Wednesday of February has always been the day, you know, for you know, National Signing Day. And, you know, it's been a kind of a slow, you know, month and a half for UCF, really, you know, ever since that bowl game, just because all the guys have been signed. I mean, you know, pretty much the only thing that happened in January was pretty much getting Brandon Wimbush as a grad transfer. And, you know, nothing really happened. Not all that much. They had a you know, only like, you know, less than five guys take an official visit. And most of those guys were just people who signed in December and couldn't visit already. They had a couple guys visit. And, you know, then when February came around, signing day last week, only two guys, you know, three if you include the preferred walk-on kicker, but only pretty much three additions. So, you know, instead of talking about, you know, 20, 25 new players and all that, it just kind of seemed like it was, you know, everything for UCF pretty much happened a month and a half ago.
I'm okay with the whole signing day thing being earlier, and I like to get these guys in and get them signed and, you know, on the dotted line and it'd be over with. I'm good with it.
Yeah, I think it's better for UCF just in terms of just how traditionally things have gone, at least where UCF is as a program. I mean, obviously, you know, it's been a great run the past few years, but as a non-Power 5, you get susceptible to, you know, other schools when all of a sudden they've got spots available. They'll try to poach your recruits at the last minute. And while that still will probably happen to a degree in that mid-December time period, I think coaches feel a lot more comfortable knowing most of their class is already locked up in mid-December. So I think in the long run, it is better to have that for where UCF is right now.
The other thing is, I think that we had an incredible class this time. This is probably one of the best classes. I think we say that pretty much every year, but I think this is definitely one of the best classes, of course, with the graduate transfers and stuff like that. But besides that, who would be your favorite or the player that you're most excited that they signed this year so far? I mean, you know, it's early. We haven't seen them do anything, but, you know, who are you looking forward to seeing do something?
You know, it's kind of hard to say who is my favorite recruit. It'll be interesting just to see. I think defensive line is, I guess, if you had to pick a favorite recruit, if you're a UCF fan, you got to hope it's some of these defensive linemen, because these guys are going to have to play next year. When you just look at who UCF is losing, and you know, there's not many guys coming back. When you talk about losing a guy like, you know, Titus Davis and Joey Connors, seniors, and you got Tristan Hill declared early for the NFL draft. I mean, there's not a lot of guys there. I guess you've got Brendan Hayes coming back as a redshirt senior. You've got Randy Charlton. There's just not a lot of bodies there, at least a lot of guys that played a lot of snaps this past season. So they signed, let me count it, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. They signed 7 defensive linemen, and they may not be done. They held back a couple of scholarships, you know, from guys who materialize late, whether that's a grad transfer or something like that. I think they'll try to maybe get an offensive lineman and a defensive lineman. That's to be determined. But there's 7 guys they're bringing in, and at least probably 4 of those guys, if not more, are going to be playing next year. It's just the way it goes with the numbers coming back. So if I had to pick a favorite, it would be somewhere on the defensive line, because as we saw, you know, for UCF to kind of continue this run, they're going to need to, you know, for all things considered, the D-line, although they didn't have a lot of depth this past year, did okay. I mean, it wasn't maybe a strength, but, you know, they did enough to get the job done. I mean, I think it's better than a lot of people expected them to be last year. So, you know, whether that's, you know, when you look at defensive tackle and you're losing guys like Joey Connors and Tristan Hill, maybe a guy like Cam Good, who is, you know, a guy that, you know, wasn't going to help UCF necessarily in the recruiting rankings because he's considered a transfer. He was class of 2018. He's from the Washington, D.C., Northern Virginia area. He initially signed with Virginia Tech, was one of their top signees a year ago. He enrolled last summer, you know, I'm not exactly sure what happened. I know he kind of had some run-ins with their strength and conditioning staff, which, you know, when you look at Virginia Tech ever since then, I mean, I've lost track of the amount of players that have left that program, guys who have quit, transferred out. I mean, it's probably in the double digits since last year, guys who were kicked off, and seems like there was something going on with that staff, whether it's the football staff, strength staff, there's something going on. But, you know, I know Cam Good did not get along with their strength staff. He might have come in a little bit on the heavier side. Maybe they were trying to get him to lose some weight. It is what it is. So he left there after July. So he was only pretty much at Virginia Tech for, like, I don't even know if it was 2 months, maybe a month and a half. He didn't even go through preseason camp, let alone the regular football season. So, you know, he signed, and, you know, he enrolled at UCF in January. Now, technically, he's considered a transfer because he was at Virginia Tech. So they're going to have to get a waiver from the NCAA in order for him to be eligible to play this upcoming season. Now, you know, because he wasn't even at Virginia Tech during the season, that's expected to happen. But, you know, until that does, you really don't know. You know, they're granting waivers all over the place. You know, you just saw what happened, you know, with Justin Fields going from Georgia to Ohio State. That was just granted this past week. So the expectation is that he'll have a waiver, but he's a guy that, you know, very, 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 you know, a lot of good things were said about him coming into Virginia Tech. He dominated in the Under Armour All-American game a year ago. So he's a guy, I know he's still young, could hopefully, you know, be ready enough to contribute this season as a defensive tackle for UCF.
Let's talk about these couple guys signed on National Signing Day in February, includes a kicker that we talked about last week, and the pipeline from Hawaii continues, and I will defer to you to attempt to say his name.
You know, I was thinking about asking that question of Coach Heupel at the press conference, and I was kind of deciding how I wanted to say it because I didn't want to butcher his name. And luckily my colleague, Jason Beatty, asked that question, but, you know, he asked the question in a creative way as well without having to pronounce his name. I think it's Lokahai Paoli. I have no idea. Okay, I'm not entirely sure.
I like your Hawaiian. I like it.
That's how it's pronounced. All I know is that he signed, and you know, for whatever reason, his recruitment was a little bit under the radar in terms of – you know, for whatever reason, he didn't really want to publicize the fact he was visiting on the last weekend. I mean, I knew he was, but, you know, he didn't tweet about it. He didn't know all these recruits always get on Instagram and Twitter and, you know, post pictures and really hype themselves. Oh, yeah, you know, great to have these coaches come visit me. Great to see these guys. Great to go on this visit. But he really was kind of low key about it. You know, it's kind of like his first name, low key. that's terrible. But yeah, he was a guy that, you know, UCF had their eye on, you know, for a long time. He was offered, I think, last April or May or something like that. Just a guy that, you know, they were aware of. And you know, I think as it became apparent in January, they wanted to get another high school offensive lineman. He did not sign early. You know, they liked his size and everything else. Obviously, he's familiar. I mean, if you're from the Honolulu, Hawaii area, I have a feeling you pretty much know everybody. And he was friends with Dylan Gabriel, obviously, who's already here. And, you know, I guess if, you know, if you're gonna, if you, you're pretty, if you're from that island and, you know, you're not going to go to Hawaii, you've got to fly a pretty far distance anyway. Most of his offers were, you know, West Coast type schools, San Diego State, Nevada, Utah State, and some of those places. But I guess you got to fly a little bit to get to those places area. So why not just go a little bit further and go to a place that really wants you, but some guys you're familiar with, like UCF. So that was one player they signed late. And the other one was James Tarver Jr., who you really didn't know much about, you know, frankly, until he kind of announced himself a few weeks back that, you know, he just got an offer from UCF and he had a home visit with you know, Heupel and all the coaches and everything. I really didn't know a whole lot about him. Heupel in the press conference said he was a guy that they liked that came to their camp last summer. And, you know, that's always an opportunity for players. You know, maybe you're a guy that gets identified early on, you get early offers, but there's the other guys who can go to a camp and, you know, maybe you're not one of those guys with the whole lot of offers. You can impress a coaching staff that way, where you get an offer at that camp or in this case of James Tarver, got it a little bit later on. He developed a lot as a senior this past year. You know, when I talk to him, you know, they don't know where he's going to play in terms of safety or corner. They just know they want him for one of those two spots. So he was a guy that, you know, didn't have a whole lot going in terms of offers. I think he had mostly, you know, FCS type schools and everything. And, you know, I know everyone's always fixated on, you know, what's their ranking, what offers did they have? Oh, wow, we beat out this team for this guy and all that kind of stuff. But I always remind people not to get, you know, don't really worry about that, because when you look at some of the best players in UCF history, in fact, some of the best players on this team right now, Richie Grant. I mean, I think if you had to rank, you know, who is the best returning player for the UCF defense, I'd say, you probably guys might agree with me or not, I don't know, I'd say it's Richie Grant. And, you know, when he was coming out of high school in the Panhandle area, the only offers he had were, I think, I can't remember, Kennesaw State, Mercer, you know, whatever it was. It was maybe some of those Southern Conference schools. His only, you know, FBS 1A offer was from UCF. You look at, you know, going back a few years now with AJ Boye, you know, now making big money in the NFL. Pretty much his only offer was from UCF. So, you know, no, he didn't really have the same amount of offers of other guys, but, you know, that doesn't matter. You know, and all it matters is when you get there and what you make of it.
One of the people that I'm the most excited about, and I know this sounds crazy, but it's this kicker that we got, because the kicker is extremely important, and we've been so lucky to have a number of kickers in a row that were very, very solid. But this guy has a heck of a leg. I watched his tape, and he just seems to really, really have a good leg and is very accurate.
Yeah, that's one thing that, you know, frankly, you know, UCF people haven't had to worry about, you know, just because, you know, you've had reliable players at kicker, punter, long snapper, and ideally you don't want to have to replace them all in the same year. But UCF is. It's not just Matt Wright graduating. You've got Mac Loudermill graduating at punter, Caleb Perez graduating at long snapper. So there's going to be three brand new starters in those roles this upcoming season. And, you know, just because, you know, for the most part, you know, obviously UCF has won a lot over these last 2 years. And it hasn't come down to a last second field goal to win the game. It hasn't come down to, heck, there's games that, you know, Mac Loudermilk would never punt, or he'd punt like once, you know, that's the way it's gone. But, you know, you need solid players in those spots. And that was big because, you know, to land Daniel Obarski from the, I guess he's from the metropolitan Phoenix area. Cause you know, UCF initially had been, going after a guy named Ryan Fitzgerald from the South Georgia area and kind of was fixated on him. He committed to Florida State a few weeks back, and, you know, no one really had him on anyone's radar because Daniel Obarski had been committed to Purdue. And, you know, I think his father went to Purdue. There was a lot of family connections there, but I know – you know, when UCF kind of made that last minute push, said, you know, we don't have anyone. We really need you. We always liked you. You know, we've got a spot right now for you to come in and get. And I think Inky wants to major in aerospace, engineering, something like that, kind of on the same track that Matthew Wright did. But, you know, I think he liked the Orlando climate. It's not too much different from Arizona versus going to West Lafayette, Indiana. It's a little bit different weather if you go up there right now. So I think all those things kind of, kind of look good to him. So that is big, you know, because, you know, UCF has won a lot of games and a lot of blowouts, but it is going to come down to, you know, a field goal kick, you know, at least sometime in these next couple of years, probably.
So the majority of the reviews put this class, or all the reviews really put this class very positive, a highest rank in that group of five. Still does, though, seem as if, though, there is a ceiling for UCF in any of those group of fives. This is a upper 40s class ranking, and it may not get much better than this when you're a member of the American.
Yeah, it kind of seems like that, and things where, you know, UCF maybe could theoretically rank higher. You know, there's, you know, transfers don't usually count. They don't count towards these rankings and everything else. Obviously, getting a guy like Brandon Wimbush, getting a guy like Cam Good, and some other players, you know, would maybe quote unquote help, but, you know, those don't count in terms of rankings. But it just kind of seems like that. While, you know, I think when you break it all down and you kind of analyze every position group and the players UCF or the different schools UCF beat out for a lot of these players, you know, to me, it jumps out as the best ever. But, you know, I know a lot's been kind of, you know, some people who, you know, people in the media or other fan bases obviously are not very, they're not fans of UCF these days. And I know there's been some pot shots kind of taken, you know, kind of calling, oh, you know, UCF won a national championship last year. They only have a recruiting class rated, you know, 49 or, you know, whatever. They didn't sign any four stars. And, you know, they're kind of taking shots at UCF. But when you kind of, you break it down and look at some of these plays, like a guy like Dylan Gabriel, you know, to sign him, he broke Tua's career passing record in Hawaii. And for whatever reason, he didn't get the recruiting attention that he did until late. You know, everyone's got the internet and can see what he's doing on Huddle. But, you know, later on in the process, you know, USC, Georgia, I mean, they wanted him bad. And I think that helped. He kind of got a little bit of a higher recruiting ranking as a result, but UCF signed him. I mean, when does that happen? UCF signed a quarterback recruit that was heavily recruited by USC and Georgia. That's not really happened. Very, I don't know if that's ever happened. You got a running back like Demarius Good, a local guy here in the Orlando area, went to Lake Brantley. He was committed to Miami for the longest time. He could have gone to Miami. He wasn't a guy that was processed like Miami for, you know, even, you know, people get upset about Big Three, you know, people kind of use that. And there was something going on in our message board a couple weeks ago about a certain recruiting writer referring to the Big Three people got, you know, kind of upset about. But for the most part, UCF hasn't really signed through the years all that many players that had legitimate offers from one of those three schools, be it Florida, Florida State, or Miami. If there was a player that UCF got, it might have been a guy that kind of fell back down. Maybe they were processed. Maybe it was a player that really wasn't being recruited anymore, you know, by those schools. Like, you know, Juwan Hamilton a few years ago, he was committed to Miami too, but they had a coaching change. He was kind of processed by Miami. But Demarius Good, he could have gone to Miami. You know, he was committed there for a long time, just decided he didn't want to go there. I think, you know, some of it had to do, I think they wanted him to play DB. He wanted to play running back, but, you know, he wasn't processed at all. And he was a guy that easily could have been in Miami's recruiting class. He's coming here. You know, you look at offensive line, you know, that's one thing where, you know, quote unquote, bigger schools always seem to get the pick of the litter, I guess you could say, in terms of signing the best players. Adrian Medley was committed to Texas A&M for, you know, pretty much the longest time. He committed there last June. And then, you know, when it came down to it, and, you know, I think it was late November or early December, you know, he just decided he didn't want to go that far. He kind of felt he could come in at UCF and contribute a little bit earlier. So he turned down Texas A&M to come here. I mean, there's more and more players. Tremon Morris Brash was one of the top defensive ends in the country, played in the Under Armour All-American game, could have gone to a lot of places because he's best friends with Cam Good, who was already coming here. You know, he had offers from Oklahoma, Maryland, and others. He didn't even worry about doing any of that. He came to UCF because he was friends with Cam Good. But you could go on and on. There were some really top players that UCF's beating out schools that they never have. So to me, you know, I think their final recruiting ranking, whatever it was, 50, 53, whatever, I'm kind of surprised because when you look and break everything down, UCF is beating out schools that they never have before.
Yeah, absolutely. I 100% agree. And these people that argue that we don't sign the classes that we should obviously don't know anything and don't know the history of the players at UCF. So we'll leave that at that. The schedule got announced as well this week. That was probably the other most exciting thing. We knew who we were playing, obviously, but we didn't know when we were playing them. How do you feel that this schedule worked out?
I think it works out pretty well. I mean, it's going to be tough to beat last year's schedule when I don't think UCF, with the way it works, they didn't have to leave the state after, I think, October 20th or whatever that last road game was against East Carolina. They didn't have to leave the state. Every game was at home, and then you had that ending game with Black Friday at USF. So nothing's going to be that good. And they also had 7 home games last year. But all things considered, I think it's pretty good, especially for, you know, the UCF fan. You know, I know people always want to complain about midweek games. You know, personally, I love midweek games because that means I could watch other college football games on Saturday. But I know for people who live out of town, maybe they, you know, fly in from other places, you know, they want to tailgate. I know those games are not ideal, but with the way it is with the American and the television contract they have with ESPN, you're going to get some. But with the way it works right now there are 3 locked in for sure. 2 of those are on a Friday on the road at Cincinnati and Tulsa. And then there's the Black Friday game with USF at home, which doesn't even count. I mean, we're talking about a weekday game. That doesn't count because everyone's off that Friday. Heck, some people are off that entire Thanksgiving week. Everyone knows it's going to be on Black Friday anyway. It's not like that's a surprise. So right now, the only other weekday home game for UCF, as it was announced, was the season opener against Florida A&M. Which may or may not stay on that date. I thought it was kind of weird. It said, you know, when the schedule release came out, it said, you know, Thursday, August 29th or Saturday, August 31st, which I thought was kind of strange. And so I asked around over there and they said, well, you know, we were kind of surprised, but the television partners have talked about, you know, we might want to televise this game. And if we do, we want to televise the game on that opening Thursday, which is kind of surprising to me because I don't think any of UCF's games against FCS opponents have ever been televised. And, you know, that just doesn't usually happen. But I think I looked at the opening week schedule, the game's, you know, already scheduled for that Thursday, and it's a pretty weak slate. There's not a whole lot of attractive, you know, television games that, you know, ESPN and CBS Sports Networks and those partners would want to cover. I think Cincinnati plays UCLA. I think that's already booked to be the marquee ESPN game. They're debuting the ACC network. And I think it's Georgia Tech, Virginia Tech. It's one of those games. I think that's already been booked for that. But outside of that, there's not many attractive games that are already scheduled on that Thursday. So if television does want it, they're going to want it on that Thursday. So they kind of announced it that way. So no one's surprised if it happens. I mean, they could have announced Saturday and said, you know, and then a month or two later from now and say, oh, TV's moving it. And then everyone gets mad at them and upset when they move it to Thursday. So right now it's tentatively on that Thursday, but they said if television does not make the final decision to do it, they will move it back to Saturday. So it just kind of depends if ESPN or CBS Sports Network want to put it on TV or not.
All right. Well, Brandon, it's always good to have you on, and we love your insight and all that stuff. Really appreciate it.
All right, guys. Thanks for having me. Take care.
Brandon, always with the insights, brings them to us.
Yeah.
Do you think he's the most frequent guest? Nightline
probably
years?
Yeah,
not counting Kyle or Nick, yeah, or now Ben, you know, where they're on.
Yeah, I think Kyle regular. Would probably,
but not counting, yeah, that because they're
not counting,
they're, yeah,
yeah,
because I mean, they're it's almost like Brandon's on the team.
He is,
yeah,
Brandon's on the team. Brandon's he has team. Been a one of the biggest supporters of what we're doing from day one, because I counted on that message board that he has to get this going, really.
So and we shouldn't
he was
even call
very
him a
supportive
guest
of that.
We should just call him part of the team.
Well, I mean, he is. We probably should talk to him about that first. But
we've recruited him. He signed his national letter of intent with us. So you mentioned real live, hard-hitting football, not tape recording.
Yeah, so this Apollo thing.
Yeah, this is real football.
You were there. I was not. Yeah. I couldn't make it. What did you think about it? I want your opinion on it, because, I mean, our opinions differ a little bit on this. But we're watching... right now, what is it, Arizona or something? And
Salt Lake
is
on
it,
the NFL
is
Network.
It Arizona? Is that what they're called?
Yep.
Or
the Hotshots. You like that, right? The logo.
I like the logo. I hate the uniforms. Man, they are ugly. But
I don't mind.
But they set it's definitely set apart from the NFL. It's kind of like when you made your own team on Madden or something. This would be the uniforms that you got as your choices. So,
all right. So observations, I will tell you,
I was a former firefighter, so I love the logo. Yes.
Yeah. I was disoriented being at the UCF home football stadium, seeing it decked out and logoed with the Apollos. It just seemed odd to me, both being in the concourse. I mean, I think they did a great job of wrapping it. It felt like their own place, you know, certainly just some of the way, the game day,
I mean, did
flow
it feel
went.
Like somebody was sleeping with your girlfriend or I mean, was it like that?
Well,
kind
I
of
mean, think
feeling?
About that now. no, not cheating, but maybe like squatters, like you went away on a trip and somebody's like staying at your house. You know, this is
The house guest that will just not go away.
I thought that someone posted on Twitter, it was great. Did you realize that the cows rent their stadium from a pro team, and UCF rents their stadium to a pro team?
Yeah, that's true. That's
like
true.
That.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, and I'm a big fan of spring football. I mean, I worked for the Orlando Thunder back in the day, did stuff with the Rage, and you know, the Predators are coming back. So I like all the little different leagues. I think it's great to have football
year
round.
This is different than a little league, though, I think.
Yeah,
they've done it right so far.
I enjoyed.
I mean, for God's sakes, they're on the NFL Network.
Yeah, I enjoyed the play. Where we differ, I'm 100% for no more kickoffs. I love that the game was 2.5 hours and they just set the ball, let's go. So it's a score. I like the 2-point conversion. I'm not anti-kicker, but I don't need to see an extra point ever again. So I like going for two. And then they just set the ball down and they're good to go. So you get rid of the timeouts, you get rid of the delays, and it's just, I like a 2.5 hour game.
As a guy that has played a lot of football, I like the traditional game of football. Now, that being said, I do like this. It's cool. It was extremely fast. It moves. It does not hardly stop. Like, television timeouts and stuff are
almost... They squeeze
back
where the commercial's on
non-existent.
One side.
Yeah. There's no... Yeah, the commercials... There was maybe one where they went full screen with a commercial during the game. Maybe, you know, I love that. I do love that the kickoffs don't take as much time after a score, commercial, lined up for a kickoff, another commercial. That's awesome. And I understand that part of it. I don't like to see the tradition of the game of football being changed by there not being certain elements.
Well, But the NFL has changed. I mean, there didn't used to be 2-point conversions, and now there are.
Well,
so they've evolved and changed.
The
there used to be instant replay. Well, yeah.
The kickoff is huge, though.
I think it's going away.
You might as well start watching rugby. I mean, you know, it's I don't know. Well, one thing I do like about it is there was no, like, padding the freaking quarterback at all.
Did you see the guy get hit?
And his head popped off?
He lost his head.
Well, I mean, it came off.
It's like Ichabod Crane, I think, was the quarterback. That's the kind of reference you get here on Knightline.
But, yeah, I mean, so they're letting him play, obviously. And the replay thing was pretty cool, too, with the lady for the Apollos game that was up there.
Every
game's
got somebody. What do they call it? The sky official?
The replay official. They're the booth.
Isn't it called something? Sky officials?
They're the booth official or replay official. That's what they do. Speaking of, I don't know if we ever talked about this.
Is the greatest commercial of the Super Bowl.
Yeah. And this is the NFL commercial. The NFL Network actually did go full screen on this commercial because it's the commercial that the NFL did during
All these
Unbelievable
players.
Unbelievable commercial.
I just heard Troy Aikman declined to do that. He didn't realize what it would be and want to commit the time to doing it. And then when he said he saw it, he instantly regretted his decision not to spend the day with all of these NFL greats filming that commercial.
Yeah. And I love the pass that my guy made there in that.
Joe Montana?
Mahomes made a little, underhanded, sideways, left-handed pass.
Joe Montana, the great Chief.
Yeah, well, no, he was too.
Oh,
he was.
Nobody thinks of him with the Chiefs.
Well, I mean, I do. He was a part of the Chiefs. He took us to the AFC Championship and lost. It's all good.
Honoring a long line of Chiefs quarterbacks.
Anyway, yeah. So this whole...
The Apollos won.
Yeah. The Apollos, this whole league is doing it right. And I tweeted last night that I hope the NFL is watching. I think I tweeted to the NFL. I just said, take note or whatever. I can't remember what I said, but it was something like that. Because they're doing this thing right completely. Of course, it's going to evolve. We're just seeing the first week of it. But I think that this is it's going to last, I think. This is not going to fold after 1 year. It's not going to fold in the middle of the season. Unless everybody gets hurt or something, I don't know. But it's great. You see names that you kind of wondered, where did that guy go? The quarterback for Atlanta is Phil Sims' kid. Mike Sims, I think is his
name.
Matt
or Mike, yeah.
Then one of the running backs for the Apollos is one of the Hunts, not the Hunt that got in trouble for kicking the girl Akeem. Or whatever. It's Akeem Hunt that was a Chief for a while, actually. There was two of them. So that was kind of cool for me to see a guy that used to be on the Kansas City Chiefs playing in this league and playing for Orlando. So that's pretty cool.
And, of course, our Knights.
Yeah.
Five UCF players on the 52-man roster, which is really good. Post-game, the lockers right next to one another, Jordan McRae and Aaron Evans, side by side. And, Jordan McRae, happy to get a win.
It's amazing, man. Just first of all, being back out here at UCF Stadium and being in front of these fans again, it was a great experience. And we've been working hard since the beginning of the camp and finally been able to take it out on somebody else. And it's been a real good time.
Yeah, so what I wanted to do was to turn around and tell everybody in the locker room, shh, Andrew's not going to like the audio.
Yeah, it is what it is. I'm just glad we have it, honestly.
And Jordan we had on a couple weeks back talking. Yep. He joined us from San Antonio.
He's one of the captains,
yeah,
at least for this game.
Yeah, Tony Girard was listed as an inactive for this game. Rennell Hall did not have much of a game, a couple of targets.
Kind of a bummer.
He was not the big star by any means in this one, but there'll be other opportunities for him.
Yeah, he will be at some point.
Spoke with Aaron Evans, as I mentioned, a locker right next to Jordan, and he was very glad to be back home.
It's just a real feeling being back here. I never thought I'd ever get the chance to play in the stadium again. Be in the bounce house again. I'm really excited to be back in our hometown, back in our home field.
And you get a win.
Yeah, exactly. A big win. So I think we made a statement tonight about our team.
What kind of team do you think this is?
I think we're going to be a powerhouse team. I think we're going to be powerful in this conference. I think we're going to get a lot of really solid looks from the NFL. And I think if you can produce like this, we're going to keep turning heads and keep having an exciting season.
All right, well, the next game up for Orlando, Apollo's first ever road game next Sunday at San Antonio.
Pretty soon I'm going to quiz you on all the team names, so prepare.
Okay, well, and everything last night was a team record, by the way, I heard. So that's awesome.
Yeah.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you, getting to like you, getting to hope you like me.
All right, that is a new segment. We get to experiment in February.
When you said this, when you talked about this, you came up with this grand idea. That song immediately popped into my head. That song from that exact episode or whatever it was popped directly.
King and I.
Yeah, dropped directly into my head.
The getting to know you segment is a little something about each of us you may not know.
And later on, we may play our friends, our little our interviewees into this as well, our guests into this,
or our team members like Brandon. He's now on the team.
Who shall start?
You shall start.
Okay.
I came up with the idea.
All right. So the way this is going to work is I'm going to say something that it may or may not be true about myself, and Trace is going to decipher whether it's true or not, or at least give his opinion, and then I will reveal the truth or not truth, and I will explain.
Are you any of you still there?
Yeah.
Don't go anywhere.
So my statement is I formerly worked for Sesame Street, and that was the tying it into the clip from before.
That's good segueing right there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it seems rather specific. So I'm going to go true because of your work in audio production and sound production and all
of
that.
I was hoping that you would say that it was false so I could be like, you were wrong.
No, it would seem to me based on your many decades.
Early in my sound career, my production career, I did work for the touring version of Sesame Street, the Sesame Street Live things. I toured all around the world with them for 3 years, working with the Sesame Street group, and it was awesome. So, yes. That is absolutely true. I was very good friends with Bert and Ernie. Ernie more so than Bert. But anyway, Bert was a little stuck up.
This is going to bring up a whole thing from Libby now. You know, she's got this thing about Muppets and Bert and Ernie.
If she only knew. And I can't tell the stories about Ernie on the air, but Ernie was played by a cute girl, I'll just say.
Inside
the costume was a cute girl.
Really?
Yes. I can't talk about it any further than that, though.
In this touring, so they're not just Muppet, they're full-fledged people.
They're people inside the costumes, yeah. So they're dancers, basically. Like you know, trained dancers, not like the shady kind of dancers.
But some
of them could have been.
I did not know about Sesame Street.
Yeah.
So
it was fun. Went all over the place. Hawaii, all over. Kids love that thing. It's been going for years and years and years. And the company that I used to work for actually just sold the operation to Feld Entertainment out of Orlando, Tampa area. And they took it over and are kind of running it into the ground, which is kind of a bummer. But anyway, lots changed. I got to meet Jim Henson and all that during that time, and lots have changed since he passed away. So anyway.
Am I up?
You're up.
I've called an audible. I was going to reveal a different one, but now I felt like I needed to segue back to something we've talked about.
Okay.
So I've alluded to the fact that I worked for the Orlando Thunder.
Yeah.
In the World League of American Football. But I haven't really talked about what I did. So.
But that's. Okay, I don't believe you. I think that that's false.
That I worked for the Orlando Thunder?
Yeah.
In ticket sales.
In ticket sales?
Well, now you have to determine whether this is true or false.
I think that that's false, personally.
Which part?
That you worked for the Orlando Thunder.
No, very much true.
And what did you do?
Very much true. So I started.
Do tell.
I do tell. I was the kicker. No.
No. Oh my God.
No.
And you want to get rid of kickoffs? Now I
know
why.
I didn't say I was a very good kicker. No, I did work for the Orlando Thunder. I was at UCF. I was a student at UCF. I started out as a volunteer during the first season. I got hired in a part-time capacity as a PR assistant. In the off season, the PR, media relations director, the Andy Seeley of the Orlando Thunder, Andy being the director of communications and PR for the
See, this is
going to
be easy for you because I forget a lot of things.
And the media relations director was removed. His assistant was promoted, and I went in one day for my shift, and he said, would you like to be the assistant director of media relations for a professional football team? And I was 20 years old.
Sure.
I said, yep.
Awesome.
Oh, and it pays? Oh, even better.
Awesome.
Now, I'll expand on this a little bit more. So there I am.
So
now,
you did not work in the ticket booth?
I did not work in ticket sales now. So I was doing this concurrently with going to school, and I would go to my classes. I didn't always do well that semester that happened. So, I mean, I got to travel. I got to go with the team. So I was doing all this amazing stuff. But in my UCF career, I did have to do grade forgiveness that semester on a couple of classes that did not go well. And there, at that time, you could grade
forgive. And one of them was media relations.
No. The irony is that one class I had to repeat was called Sport in American History with Dr. Richard Kripo. And it was just a class where we took three tests, and I did well on two of them, but I did not do well on one of them. And so my grade was not good. And I had pretty good grades in college. So he was very cool in that he was like, it's really great you're doing this, but it really has nothing to do with the fact that you have to study and take tests. So yeah. I'm happy for you, and we can talk about this spring league all we want. You still have to do things. So I grade forgave the class. And his sort of penalty to me was, in doing it, that I was going to have to read 10 books and write 10 papers.
Oh.
That didn't happen.
Yeah.
So the grade forgive classes that I had to take, I did fine on when I took them again. The only class I failed at UCF was sports. American
wow.
history.
Wow. Okay.
Because I didn't do any of the work.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah. Well, you did do the work, though. But not the work for the class.
I had a choice between read the 10 books or go to Montreal with the Orlando Thunder when they played the Sacramento Surge. And I made the decision as a 20-year-old that the life experience and
still friends
from that period of time, lifelong friends, I made a decision.
I'd be packing my bags.
So, and it, changed the course of my life. But I failed that class.
All right. This was an eye-opening experience.
Okay.
This little segment. I hope you all enjoyed it.
So it'll survive. It'll come back.
Yeah,
again.
It'll come back. I enjoyed it. Learned something every day.
Now you're getting to know a little bit about each of us, whether you want to.
I need to have something.
The music
the
again?
End. Yeah. No. But it is nice music. I've always loved that song.
Yeah, that's a good song.
Anyway.
Well, still no back-to-back losses for men's basketball as the Knights win Sunday. Analysis from former men's basketball player Ben Stout just ahead. Knightline. You can check us out at nightlinesports.com for archived episodes. Go back and listen to the Sons of UCF for their Wyatt Miller interview. You go back and listen to Jordan McRae. We had him just a couple of weeks ago. Plenty of great guests on the Nightline Sports Network.
You've heard us talk about the great food at our good friend Kyle Israel's restaurant, The Little Greek Fresh Grill. The Little Greek now has franchises available. Please call 407-697-2272. That's 407-697-2272 to see what The Little Greek can do for you. Also, check out The Little Greek's newest location at 6536 Old Brick Road in Windermere, Florida. The Little Greek Fresh Grill. Fresh, flavorful, fabulous.
Men's basketball gets the road win Sunday, 71-65 at SMU. Knights 7-3 in the American. Sounds pretty good, right? 7-3, 70%, 17-5 overall. Aubrey Dawkins with a big game, 26. Knights were 12 of 13 from the free throw line, and that doesn't happen every game.
Thank goodness Aubrey got it together.
Yeah.
I was a little worried.
Now go back, though, to Thursday. The Knights dropped an important home game to 12th-ranked Houston, 77-68. Following the loss, we don't always get the interview access with the opposing coach, but they brought Cougars head coach Kelvin Sampson in, and I asked him if UCF, the preseason pick to win the American, was still a threat to do just that.
Considering this result, is UCF still a threat to win the conference this year?
Sure. Still early. You got to be really good to come in here and beat this team.
So in the spirit of fair play, asked it to Johnny Dawkins too.
You're halfway through league play. I think we have a good team. I think we have to get better. I think we have a good team. You know, we just played one of the top 15 teams in the nation, and they're playing well. I mean, I think if you look at the game, I think there's some areas we can be better, and I'm sure they feel the same way about what they did. But I think we can compete with the best teams in our league. We just have to go out there and do it.
What do you got to do to win the league?
We're halfway through the league now, and we're three games. I think we're two games behind. So two games behind. We need to make sure that we lock in. We got each one of these games has to be like a championship game for us. We play some of these teams. We play Houston again, and we play some of these teams. So we have opportunities. To me, everything is right in front of us. We have to go out there and make it happen.
Well, it's Houston, 12th ranked.
Yeah.
They came in to Orlando and they punched UCF in the face.
Yeah.
Right? They punched him in the nose.
You get back up when you get punched in the face.
That sounds like a song.
And you keep going. I get back up.
Oh, boy. Houston, as it is 17-0 at home, 6-1 on the road. UCF's looking up now. Houston beats Cincinnati in Houston. Cincinnati is now a game off the pace. You know, when you're talking, you're into single digits on games.
Yeah, this
you
is gotta not...
swing. I mean, they have a game with Cincinnati still to come at home, and a game at Cincinnati on the road, and they play Houston on the road. Psychologically,
all is not lost.
No, but
at all.
I think they're the third best team in the league. That's what I think. Looking up at Houston and Cincinnati, and if you don't knock off Houston and Cincinnati, you're gonna be third.
Yeah. Well,
and this week they play 4-5.
And then there's a tournament after that.
I know.
And you play again, probably those same teams in the tournament, unless you get knocked out by, somebody way lower than you and all that.
So, they're still in position here. All is not lost,
Not at all.
It's in terms of the SMU game, it was good, a good road win, and UCF... really now just kind of a bubble team, but you get a couple more wins this week. You have a chance to go 2-0, right? You've got the Cows at home. We're on I-4 game. You got Memphis rematch, but they're here. And UCF has been playing well at home, 11-2, which includes the Houston loss. So got to protect the home court.
Yeah.
They're 3-0 on neutral court because they won that tournament in South Carolina. 3-3 on the road. And again, they end up with several games on the road. So you're probably going to stumble on the road. Somewhere along the line, you gotta protect the home court, as we get into with Ben. Let's turn to former UCF men's basketball player Ben Stout for some perspective inside the paint. Ben, there are optimists who only see the greatest things. There are the pessimists who see gloom and doom. There are the realists who provide perspective. We're looking to you for some realism and some analysis after the Thursday-Sunday combo, the loss to Houston, the win on the road at SMU. Let's talk about the rebound on Sunday. Aubrey Dawkins comes back to the forefront. Season-high 26 points. Pretty good outing for Colin Smith. Season-high 18 points, 10 rebounds. UCF avoids back-to-back losses, gets a critical win on the road in Dallas. You got to like how the team responded after the setback Thursday.
Yeah, definitely. It's great speaking with you guys. And it certainly today was great to see them bounce back. And it's been a little bit of a signature for our team this year, luckily for us fans, that we haven't, now I'm knock on wood as I say this, but we haven't lost a back-to-back game, back-to-back games all year. So, we have shown that we have a little bit of fight in us. We have some resiliency and we can come back and bounce back, whether it be on the road today, which is probably one of our, one of our tougher games since it was on the road against a team that was pretty solid. It was one of our tougher games after a loss that we had to face. So it was good to see them bounce back. And as you mentioned, it was especially good to see Aubrey Dawkins bounce back and have an awesome game. He really looked aggressive from the early onset. He hit two quick threes, and it was certainly great to see him get his feet back underneath him and really understand, you know, really finding his place and being aggressive today.
Also, the Knights 12 of 13 from the free throw line. Yes, you heard correct. 12 of 13 from the free throw line, which, of course, proves that they can do it. However, can they sustain it? Still, in a close game, being nearly perfect from the line proves to be a difference.
Yeah, and a close game again on the road. So I had told you, or I was texting back and forth with you earlier, Trace, and I said I had to rewind the rewind the TV there to make sure when I saw the graphic pull up that we were 8 from 9 from the free throw line. So certainly caught me by surprise. We've shown it, as I said last week, we showed it in the UConn game down the stretch in a relatively what could have gone close game there, where we went 10 of 12 down the stretch at home. So to see them go 12 of 13 from the line today on the road was great to see.
7-3 in league play, 17-5 overall. I'm going to try my best over the weeks ahead to avoid the cliche that it's a must-win game, because it's conference play. Every game, home or away, as much as you can make, is a must-win game. What do you see in this performance that still concerns you, maybe from the defensive standpoint? Because Johnny Dawkins in his seasons here at UCF has talked about how this is going to be a defensive-minded team, that the defense will drive the offense, and it seems as if, though, there are lapses. Maybe not the right word choice. What would you say?
Yeah, I'd agree. I'd agree with that. There's some great things to look at. We are still a good defensive team, but there are periods of the game where we fall short and lack that consistency that we need to be a great defensive team. And it's unfortunate because we certainly have the potential to do so. I think what's been a little bit of a mystery still with this team is. I think we were looking mostly on the offensive side of the ball and how BJ and how Aubrey was going to fit in with this team, and how BJ and him were going to play together along with Terrell Allen coming in on the starting lineup. But we kind of looked at the defensive side of the ball as a little bit of a given, which is easy to do when you've got Taco Fall 7'6" down there protecting the rim. But what we've done in the past, as far as defensive scheme wise, is we've played a lot more man to man in the past. And as I said, when you and I, when the three of us talked before the season started, what I said made our defense so great is it allowed our guards to really press up on the man that they were guarding him, and because they knew they had that kind of safety blanket behind them in Taco Fall. And with the matchup zone, this kind of unique or odd matchup zone that Coach Dawkins has installed this year with this team, sometimes it's really successful. We saw that in the first half of the UConn game, where they were deflecting every single ball that came through the lane, and they were getting a lot of steals and turning that around into buckets. I mean, there are sometimes where long stretches it can be successful, but there's also long stretches where they get a little bit lost, and where they get lost the most, in my opinion, is our guards, especially. They switch everything. So, it's pretty easy to just come off of a ball screen. If you're the opposing guard, it's pretty easy to just come off a ball screen to get the matchup that you want, because we switch all the time. Like, we switch instead of just trying to fight over a screen, which is sometimes we should. We always switch that man. So all of a sudden, a big man is guarding a much quicker guard, or a much smaller guy is guarding a much bigger guy. And I wouldn't mind seeing them kind of hedge a little bit to stop the ball handler, and then allow that player to fight over the top of that screen. And so what happens is we just wound up for stretches where we look a little bit lost. And the most vulnerable part of our defense right now is the weak side. So if you swing it over to one side of the court and then quickly either drive down the lane and kick it to the weak side for an open three or a backdoor cut, that's been really vulnerable this year. And so I wouldn't mind Coach Dawkins going back to a little bit more straight up man-to-man this year in the games ahead to see if that'll work to allow our guards to just say, hey, stay with your man. No switching anymore when it's a lazy screen, and no more searching for who you should guard in the zone. Just stay on your man and stay with him and play straight up basketball. And I think we could have success with that.
One of the things that you texted me during Sunday's game that I thought provocative was the phrase, "It's a gift and a curse to have someone the size of Taco Fall." And I'm not sure that I've heard it phrased quite that way or with that sentiment. Maybe expand upon that a little bit more after what you just shared as you're analyzing their play on defense.
Yeah, and I'll preface this answer or this statement with, Taco is, I've obviously got a huge bias towards Taco. I mean, I think he's one of my favorite basketball players to ever wear a UCF uniform. I really enjoy watching him play, and I would rather he be on no other team in the country than ours. So, but there are, I think what I just talked about as far as the, I would like to see us go to man-to-man more consistently. I think one of the reasons why Coach Dawkins hasn't made that leap this year is because he's worried a little bit about Taco Fall and how he could get run around on the court, especially on the defensive end of the court. And that's not necessarily a knock on Taco. He's a fantastic defensive player. What that really is speaking to is our conference. When our conference is a very guard heavy, smaller, quick conference, I couldn't name you a single, straight up traditional center any other team in our conference except for ours. And we happen to have a couple of them, but our conference is full of big men who are not really big men. They're skilled players who like to play on the perimeter, like to drive the ball if they need to, but certainly fast players that can play. These teams can play five out, and that becomes an issue when you're getting Taco that far away from the basket. If he's chasing down a smaller man. So he's a gift in the sense that he is a great rim protector when it's working, but it's a little bit of a curse when they're running him around the court and kind of taking advantage of getting him away from the basket and allowing that backside to be vulnerable.
At the outset of this interview, I talked about being an optimistic observer, a pessimistic observer, a realistic observer. I'd view you as a realist who wants nothing but the best for this program and for UCF. So in that regard, you're looking for the positive, but you know when to be critical. And I mentioned that because I saw some banter on Twitter, and I have a great deal of respect for our fans. While I certainly don't agree with all of them, there was one that you engaged with on Sunday that claims, and I quote, "I'm a realistic fan who demands more from a team that can perform a lot better with a coaching staff who should prepare them to play more confidently and tougher." And I again go back that this is a team that's 7-3 and 17-5 overall, and having gone through the Donnie Jones era, I'm at a loss for why there are people clamoring for Johnny Dawkins' head in the midst of what has been, a positive season so far. How does that sort of sentiment? I know you disagree with the gentleman, the individual.
Yes.
What are you tapping into, though, when you're talking with folks? Is it the unrealistic? Is it expectations that perhaps are unrealistic? Is it when they're projected to win the American and you're sitting there looking up at Houston and Cincinnati, who had a heck of a game on Sunday, that it's just the expectation, the culture now at UCF? Is it that 1-0 mentality? We just got to win every game? What is it?
So it's a mixture of a lot of things. A lot of the things that you just mentioned, Trace. I kind of got back and forth. It's one of those, one of those things that after you start engaging in that, you you think to yourself, oh man, maybe I should have just just stopped, because you don't want to say anything that you shouldn't. Because as I said before, you'd always want a passionate fan base rather than an indifferent fan base. So the passion is a good thing. I just I do take a little bit of umbrage with the short-term memory of how this team was operating as a short period of time ago. That was only like about 4 or 5 years ago under a different coaching staff. I mean, this team is tough, and this team is motivated, and they play hard, and they play for each other. And a lot of that is a reflection. And it, you know what? Sometimes they play poised. They play very poised at times. And all of those traits that I just mentioned is a reflection of Coach Dawkins. And I believe in Coach Dawkins. He's, I mean, we won, what, 21 games last year, I believe, or close to it anyways, with almost all of our starters injured or out for the year for long periods of time. And so Coach Dawkins and his staff have done a great job with this team, and I know that they'll continue to do a great job. And I don't mind some things, you know, some fans being critical of what goes on with the games, because, you know, there are certain things that you can point to that I even just mentioned about the defensive lapses where, you know, we certainly want more. But I guess I take a little bit of, I get a little bit hot under the collar at the yeah, but guy. I mean, every time you say something positive about the team, they say, yeah, but, well, we should do that. You know, I said something about Aubrey, you know, having his best game of the season, which I believe he did, especially under the circumstances today, you know, where he was having a really rough stretch there for three games, and he bounced back to have a great game today. And, you know, you get a comment, immediate comment of, oh, yeah, you should do that against SMU. And it's like, well, hold on here. Like, which way are we going? And so I think it's a little bit of a kind of short-term memory loss of the way it was before Dawkins. It's the expectations that are leaking over from the fall sports, which, you know, quite frankly, those are good expectations to have. And then I think a little bit of it is looking at the potential that this team has and wanting more from what we've seen. And when it comes to that, that is where I look at this team at a very optimistic view, because what, you know, because the opportunity for this team to be a historically great team when it comes to the D1 era of UCF basketball, that opportunity is right there in front of us with these last number of games to finish out this season. So if we lose all of these games coming up, then it was a bad collapse, and we can certainly point to some things that we'd be upset about. But if we win a number of these games, I mean, we play some seriously quality opponents coming up, and so I choose to look at the good things about those matchups and the positivity about that, about the opportunities coming up, in a way that might be slightly different than some of our fans.
If we're being realistic, Thursday, though, Houston came into Orlando and delivered a punch. Doesn't necessarily
they
mean
did.
It's a knockout punch. Houston continues its winning streak at home Sunday, beating Cincinnati. So you're looking up, if you're UCF, at Houston and Cincinnati, right a notch below are our friends from Tampa and Memphis, and that's the next two opponents home this week. And I'm reminded of something that Houston coach Kelvin Sampson said in the post game when he said, you got to protect your home court. UCF's going to have a tough road stretch to end the regular season. So this is a week, again, I'm going to avoid the cliche of must win, but this is a week when this is a team that has to go 1-0 twice this week.
Yeah.
And what do they have to do? What do they have to do when you join us a week out to look back on this as a successful 2-0 week?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, some of the things I mentioned to you going into the UConn game, I think we absolutely have to do that against this team, where or the, both the teams this week, especially on Saturday against Memphis. We need to establish Taco early on, and we've done that pretty well over the last few games. I mean, everything kind of went wrong after we tied it up at 17 against Houston. They kind of popped at it on a 10-0 run, and it was just Houston is a really, really elite team. Any team in the country is going to have a lot of issues, a lot of trouble with them. And we saw that against a very good team in Cincinnati today, where they were able to pull out that win at home. And so the Houston, I guess, matchup aside, what we need to do this week against USF, who has a pretty good center in the middle that we'll want to match up with Taco, and that might actually work out in our favor defensively. But we do need to go inside early. We did it well today in the first half. It opened up those the shots for the rest of our players, especially Aubrey today. He had two quick threes, and I think that was a result of going down low and getting an and-one for Taco earlier. Early in the game. So I'd like to see us establish our big man early and our size advantage early against USF and show that we can really impose our will against them. But when it comes to Memphis, that's a revenge game. And from the last couple Sundays ago, I hope that our guys have had that game circled. I don't want to overlook USF by any means, but I hope that they're going to be ready to go after that USF game and really, really itching to show that what happened at the FedEx Forum is not going to happen on our home court. Memphis has been a team that has been fantastic at home, which is not going to be great if we match up with them in the conference championship, but they have been very vulnerable and looked like a totally different team on the road. And so I don't want to hope that they look like that against us, but I want our team to make them look like they are that vulnerable team on the road that they have been this year. And so I think we need to tighten up those defensive lapses. I'd like to see a practice this week. I'd hope that Coach Dawkins would implement a little bit of man-to-man that we saw in the second half of the game today against SMU. It didn't work for a couple stretches, but I believe that's because we haven't practiced it as much. I'd like to see him implement a little bit of more man-to-man matchups in practice this week leading up to these two games. And we've had this 1-0 mentality when we've been talking, and we've gone 1-1 or 2-1 the last few weeks. And this looks like one of those weeks where sitting at 17-5, like we are, where you got to go 2-0 this week. These are two games that we got to go get. And because they're at home and we need to be set up going into that Cincinnati game after that and the many difficult games to come. So certainly at home, we got to protect home court, and I hope we bring a big crowd and hope we're able to pull it off.
You will find Ben Stout's insights on Twitter at BigSocial32. You hear his commentary and analysis only on the Knightline Sports Network weekly here with us. Ben Stout, thank you for going 1-0 on Knightline number 180 this week.
Thanks a lot, guys. Appreciate it. Have a good one.
All right. Next up, the improved cows. Golly, I don't like to say that. Come to town Wednesday, February 13th, 7 o'clock at the arena. And then Memphis, a little rematch there, Saturday the 16th at 6.
All right. Your Knightline planner, women's basketball, hits the road at Tulane on Wednesday the 13th before welcoming UConn on the 17th. Women's tennis is at Bama on the 15th, at Old Miss on the 17th. Softball hits the road to Puerto Vallarta, Mexico for the PV College Challenge. Friday versus Washington. Saturday, the Knights have games with Northern Colorado and Mississippi State. Sunday versus Sacramento State on the 16th. Women's golf is in Gainesville for the Gator Invitational.
That's well done on the Nightline Planner.
Thanks. That's probably the first time I've ever done it, to be honest with you.
Usually do that. 2019 UCF baseball season gets underway at home Friday, and our countdown to the first pitch continues with a pair of one-on-ones. Knights head coach Greg Lovelady is looking to sophomore third baseman Griffin Bernardo to boost the offense.
Talk about your game. How do you think you've improved the most?
I think I've improved in all areas of the game. Hitting, defense, speed. We got a new strength coach, Jeremy, and we do a lot in the weight room. I think that everything's really improved.
What can we expect to see from you at the plate?
I expect a jump in power numbers, more home runs, more doubles. That's really my biggest goal this year, is just to hit for more power and help the team win and generate runs.
One of the storylines this season going in is going to be, how do you replace Ryland Thomas's big bat? But maybe you don't replace it with one guy.
Yeah.
Maybe get a couple of guys that boost their numbers, just as you mentioned, you think you can hit for more power.
I agree.
And then you don't look to one guy as much.
Exactly. So we lose Ryland, which is obviously a big bat, but like I was just talking about, I think our lineup this year is going to be a lot more complete. We're going to have a lot more guys that are going to be able to generate runs. And I think from top to bottom, it's just going to be a really potent lineup. And I think we're always going to be able to generate runs.
What about defensively? Can that be a strength for this team?
I think so, yes, sir. We got a lot of guys coming back, a lot of returners, a lot more maturity on the field this year at the D1 level. And I think that defensively, we can clean some stuff up. And I think it's going to be a strong point for this team.
Heard a couple of guys say not so much the chemistry was off last year, but maybe you weren't always in sync. Mm-hmm. Is that a fair way to think back on last season? Maybe things were just off a little bit from time to time, and that can cost you a couple of games over the course of a season.
So I would agree with that. I think that last year at times we were definitely out of sync as a team, and I think that definitely hindered us in some ways. But you know, this year you don't get that feeling at all, and sometimes it's just a random blend of characters. Like sometimes it just doesn't mix very well at certain points, and this year you haven't gotten that vibe at all this year, and it's been a great year so far, looking to keep it up.
Projected middle of the pack, do you care? Does it matter? Does that ever matter in January, February?
No, I talk about this all the time with my roommate Dalton. I don't think preseason projections shouldn't even be a thing, in my opinion. I don't think that they matter in the slightest. The game of baseball changes every day. It's a day-to-day game. It's an at-bat-to-at-bat game. You have no idea what's going to happen, and I don't think projections are fair. I don't think they're right, and I don't think they really mean that much.
It's a talking point.
Exactly.
When you've got a weekend series in Connecticut and it's 24 degrees,
exactly.
Does it really matter who's projected where, or even where you are in the standings? Because you can go there, and they can get you.
Everything could change in one weekend. You could go and have a great weekend, win two out of three, or sweep a conference team, and the projections just, they don't play into them at all.
Baseball's a longer season. With that 1-0, which gets a lot of football talk. Mm-hmm. Coach Heupel, 1-0, 1-0. But there's a lot of that that's important in baseball, too. I mean, it doesn't matter what you did yesterday.
It's a new game
today. How do you do that mentally?
Well, one of the pillars of our game is mental game. So we talk with Coach Lovelady a lot about that. We have mental meetings. We discuss different ways to deal with the game, deal with the failures. And I think the biggest thing is just understanding who you are as a person and who you are as a baseball player, and what you need to do in certain situations to mentally either calm yourself down, hype yourself up, whatever you need. And I think that balance is what's going to keep you mentally strong throughout the entire season.
Confident.
Very confident.
You like that?
Jeez, I've gotten better at everything.
He also interviewed me, and I said the same.
Oh, good. Good. Nice.
You get plenty of bang for your buck with redshirt senior outfielder Tyler Osick, too. His 56 RBIs led the American last season.
All right, what's the outlook for this season? What do you think of the makeup of this team?
I think we got a really good makeup on this team. We got a lot of experience back offensively, a bunch of experience back on the pitching staff, and we have some really good junior college transfers as well coming in to help us. And I think we have a good we're all focused on one goal, to win a championship, opposed to personal goals and exterior things.
What did you learn about your game over the course of last season? Like, how did you change over the course of the season?
I learned about my game that I can play at this level, but I also learned that you need to stick with your approach, because there is going to be times when you're not feeling that well at the plate, and and the scouting report gets out. You just need to stick with your approach and just continue to go, take it pitch by pitch, opposed to thinking of the big picture.
What can we expect when we see you?
You can expect a guy who's going to compete every at-bat, try and win pitches, compete my hardest, and just help the team win.
Rylan Thomas is a big back.
Yeah.
How do you replace Rylan Thomas' big back? Can you do it with one guy, or do you need a couple of guys, several guys to step up?
I think the way that we're going to replace Rylan Thomas' bat is just a bunch of different guys that have more experience, whether it's summer ball or a kid like Anthony George coming back. I think Anthony George and Griffin Bernardo are going to help us a lot and replace Rylan's bat.
What about your bat?
I'm going to have a good year. I've been working really hard, so I'm ready to go, and I'm going to try and put up some good numbers and help this team win.
What about this team defensively? What can it be defensively?
I think it could be a great defensive team. We got Rayleigh up the middle. We're very good. We got Anthony George catching. We got Brandon Hernandez and Matt Micah, who are both really good middle infielders, senior infielders. And we got Rayleigh in center field, who's a great outfielder. So I think we could have a really good defense.
You guys lost a lot of players, and prominent players to MLB.
Yeah.
Does that impact chemistry?
It doesn't. I think that that was one of our main goals from the day we stepped on campus back in August was to mesh good with the new players that are joining our team and have good chemistry and have our one goal is to win championships, not have exterior personal goals like the draft, like that might have got in front of us last year. So this year we just have a different mindset.
What was Coach's message on that? Because how do you do that? You know, a guy like Ray Alejo is going to be amongst the nation's leaders in stolen bases,
yeah.
Which obviously, if he's doing well, the team is going to be doing well. He's getting on base. How do you separate the two, your personal stats, from getting that W? And how does Coach communicate that?
Yeah, Coach communicates it. He knows that. He explains to us that if you go out and you focus on your team and you focus on winning games and the more games you win, the better that and the better you do individually, it'll help you down the road, like with personal wins, like with Ray. But if your main focus is trying to win games and win pitches, everything will fall in line for you personally as well.
Where were you, Waffle House, doing this dang thing?
They were smattered, covered, and smothered in the back.
I thought I heard somebody flipping the spatula in the back there, hitting the spatula on the grill.
More from the Knights with distracting background audio later this week in Knightline Now. And be sure to listen back to our one-on-ones with Ray Alejo and Dallas Beaver from Friday's Knightline Now. First pitch. Oh, it's great to have baseball back. Siena, the Saints, Friday, February 15th at 6, Saturday at 6-2, Sunday at 1. Baseball is back.
One other note, former Knights catcher Drew Butera, the ninth-year vet, has signed a minor league deal with the Phillies, which is kind of interesting.
Has a chance to make the club, though.
Yeah, but he was on the Royals. So Butera has bounced around with the Twins, the Dodgers, Angels, Royals, and Rockies.
So three more teams, and I'll have been on every one of them.
Yeah.
You know, he's really great defensively and really handles pitchers well.
Yeah, so, I mean, I thought that he was still on the Royals. I didn't even know about this Rockies thing. Yeah.
The bat?
Oh, yeah. Is that where he struggles?
Yeah.
I remember he filled in for our catcher when he was hurt, like, during that year. I think he was on, our World Series team, winning team?
Yeah. He's a career 201 average.
He filled in great as a catcher. At that time, though. So,
This is a direct quote. It's not my statement, though I tend to agree with it. Why do the cows suck so bad? That's a question. And ask Knightline when Knightline number 180 returns.
No, they do.
Spice up your company with homemade marketing services from Tasty Gravy Creative. Tasty Gravy serves up a menu of budget-friendly marketing, graphic design, and public relations services customized to your specific goals. Co-owned by a UCF graduate, Tasty Gravy can help refresh your brand, strengthen your online presence, or reinforce your company's message. Contact Tasty Gravy for help with your website, social media, marketing, advertising materials, and more. Visit tastygravy.com.
Hey, Night Nation. It's Adam from the Sons of UCF. Be sure to check out our show every Wednesday only on the Nightline Sports Network. Now, back to two guys who probably won't be Cow of the Week nominees, Andrew and Trace.
Ask a Nightline is brought to you by Chad Barlaw. Chad is a UCF alumnus and diehard Knights fan. Chad Bar Law handles auto accident, slip and fall, and personal injury cases. Call Chad today at 407-599-9036 for a free consultation. That's 407-599-9036. Armor up and call Chad Bar Law today.
Tis that time again, time to ask Knightline, where we answer questions that you post to us on our Facebook page or via Twitter at the hashtag AskNightline. At Scoville02, can Hype teach Wimbush, Brandon Wimbush, new transfer from Notre Dame, the deep ball? Obviously, Wimbush struggled in the completion percentage department with Notre Dame. You see him, especially with Hype, liking to throw deep, that he's going to improve on his accuracy.
Well, I mean,
just by his being a quarterback.
That was one of, I mean, that's, he has a heck of an arm. Yeah. He does. I mean, he has the power. Mm-hmm. Accuracy may be the issue, but I mean, if you looked at his tape from his Notre Dame highlight reel that was going around right after he transferred here, he threw, I mean, there were a lot of highlights with pretty deep balls there. So, I think that he can throw that pretty good. I mean, as far as strength, accuracy can always be improved, though, with different drills and stuff. So, yeah, I mean, why not?
Gotcha. At Golden Knight underscore the second, looking at the 19, I love that, by the way, 19, it all just works together with a K, signing class, what five players will make the biggest impact next season? And you may not be able to name five, so I'd like to hear seven.
Well, I'm going to say, number one, the new kicker will make a heck of an impact.
The great Obarski.
Yeah, well, yeah, the big Obarski or whatever.
Oh, the big. Oh, that's the name of that movie, yeah. The Big Lebowski.
Yeah.
Daniel Obarski.
Yeah, he's obviously going to make a big impact with the ball.
Yeah.
with his foot. Anyway, and then, you know, obviously, I think the offensive and defensive linemen. So I'm just going to group them together because
opportunities
honestly,
that's for the easiest. New recruits to earn starting time.
Absolutely, because we need to replace some guys there. We talked about it at the beginning of the show. Yeah. We talked about it with Brandon. Those guys on both sides of the ball are really going to get a big opportunity to do something special.
I'd like to throw in the punter.
Yeah, that's true, too. And the long snapper, because we need that, too. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, you can throw in all those guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, all right. So, some questions come in a little bit both sides of the fence on Johnny Dawkins. Brando Nitro, at Brando Nitro, why are people clamoring to fire Dawkins when we're having one of the best basketball seasons in recent history? Houston, a legitimate top 10 team. We kept it close in the end. And that's contrasted with our friend Travis Dever, at NSB Realtor, who asks, why can't Dawkins get this team together?
Oh, God.
So,
Travis.
That's true. I mean, it's not isolated. There's a little bit of a discontent and a clamor, and we talked about it with Ben. We've talked about it in previous weeks. I think it's completely off base to be clamoring for his job. And I know it's some people, it's not everybody, but I think it's an expectations game. I think people see we were projected to win the American and go to the NCAA tournament, not just go, but win. And now they're looking up at Houston and Cincinnati, and it feels a little deflating.
Well, and you know, another thing is I think that I think that people got used to winning so much in football, to be honest with you, even if they're you know, maybe these are casual basketball fans that are saying this more than anything about firing Johnny Dawkins. That's crazy.
Do we give life to it by even talking about it?
No, I mean, because we're debunking it. I mean, by talking about it. And that's crazy talk about firing him. It's just, I just feel like when people mention this, do you really want to go back to the years of Donnie Jones?
No.
I mean,
no.
That's just what I think of when people say that. Dawkins is a huge step up from Donnie Jones. And I just don't ever want to see that kind of thing happen again. Now, to answer Travis's question, he's working on it. I mean, I think this takes time. He's still got some players that are Donnie Jones players. He hasn't fully been able to do what he wants to do yet, I don't think. I honestly don't think so. Because, I mean, I said it, and you know, I said it before. I think that Taco sometimes makes it more difficult to work in this thing. I don't think he necessarily helps all the time. He can be a liability.
Well, Ben talked about that. You know, blessing and a curse.
Yeah. So, I think that this team is going to change quite a bit when you don't have a guy like Taco and all the attention that he gets and everything else. Because if you watch a game on TV, all they do is talk about Taco. But Taco's not the best player on the floor. He's just a 7'6" guy. Mm. So I think when he can be a little bit of a distraction, to be honest with you. And I think once he's done and moves on to the NBA or wherever, you know, Spain or Japan or wherever he's going to play ball, I think that this team will mold a little bit better, gel a little bit better, personally. That's my personal opinion. You can, you know, I'm wrong a lot, but in some people's eyes.
That's a good poll question. How often is it? No. And you know what Johnny Dawkins never did that Donnie Jones did? Johnny Dawkins never blocked you on Twitter.
That's true. Not yet.
Thin-skinned Donnie Jones.
Yeah.
Blocking people on Twitter.
Yeah.
Brando Nitro's got a second question, moving off basketball. Do we care about recruiting rankings compared to P5 schools? Obviously, it isn't very accurate.
Nope. Doesn't matter.
To the extent that I care about it, it's just that there is a clear ceiling on how far a group of five program can go in the rankings. And I think it's very apparent now, after arguably the best recruiting class and being able to get some high-profile transfers, UCF has always had to be the little engine that could and coach up.
I love being the little engine that could, though. I love it. I think that's one of the best things about all this.
At the end of the day, I don't think we can care about it.
It doesn't matter, because it does not matter what anybody else thinks about anything as far as that goes. It doesn't matter, because we know what's going to happen with these guys. We know the history of UCF and producing with players, obviously. You know, I mean, look at the history of these players, just like Brandon talked about earlier. We talked about it with him. Doesn't matter.
At @testo_Tim, a little shout out. Tim was in Dallas for UCF at SMU.
Nice.
Yeah. And
saw Carson there, yeah, too. Carson and Engel. Carson was at the game on Thursday night here.
So. Carson gets around. Carson Engel moving back.
Yeah. I'm excited about that. You're going to hear more of Carson Engel on the Knightline Sports Network, I believe.
Really?
At some point.
Getting to know him. Oh, no, I know. Testo @_Tim. I just looked at the Lady Hoops AP Top 25. Can you tell me how at 20-3 UCF has a single vote in the Top 25?
That's crazy.
It is a level of, we can get into this, a level of disrespect. But I also think it's a program that, while has had a recent run of success, it's not a traditional power where you just think of UCF when you think of women's basketball in the way in which you do UConn or a Tennessee or, you know what I mean? Those traditional Notre Dame, these traditional programs that are good. And that's a long haul build for Coach Abe and the program. And they've done it now for a couple of years, but it's still not, you just don't think of UCF. It's not fair. We talked about it during football. They buy into brand names. Yep. They're not looking at results. And
sustained excellence will fix that, I think.
Yeah.
So if it can be sustained, I think that will work for them. They'll get in it. And honestly, the men could be up in there as well, to be honest with you. I mean, really, with the record, they could be and possibly should be up in there.
All right. @Stetson_1883, series of rapid fire questions here. We'll put them all together. But the premise is, why do the cows suck so bad? But why? Seriously, why? Genshaft, referencing their former president, Judy Genshaft. Garbage campus? No on-campus stadium? What makes them so awful. I think that the question was sincere.
This guy's not a Cows fan, is he?
No. Okay. I think we're a little tongue-in-cheek with all of this, but I think there is a serious question that they're, at least at this snapshot in time, and we talk about it in news and notes, but UCF has stretched out a pretty sizable lead with another opportunity at the Warren I-4 points this week.
You know, I have the answer.
Yeah.
It's no vision by anybody that's an athletic director.
They have a new athletic director.
Well, then he needs, I mean, I guess we'll see what happens with that, but I believe that all these things, Genshaft does have a big doing in it, but I think it's athletic directors not having the vision that our athletic directors have had. I mean, even though, you know, we talk bad sometimes about Stansbury or whatever, and people before him that were athletic directors here that got us in a little trouble or whatever, trouble.
they rhyme, synonyms.
We have, especially currently, we have the best athletic director in the entire country.
In all of the Americas.
In all of them. Yeah, all of the Americas.
No, I think you're right about this because we joked about them renting from a pro team versus UCF renting to a pro team in a Twitter post that has made the rounds.
It's true.
There is truth in that. There is a lack of vision, and they don't have the buzz. They have not capitalized on what success that they have had, and they like to point that they were number two in the country at one point, but they didn't parlay that.
Where did they wind up when they were?
They weren't even
two.
In the top 25. Yeah. But it is a lack of vision, and you see that by their struggle.
I still don't understand how they were number two.
Cheating.
Something. Somebody needs.
But the lack of vision, I think it hits on it. They have not captured the alumni attention on fundraising. We've shared in the past,
and that ugly green. The ugly green.
It's just colors.
It's ugly.
Yeah. They trail behind on fundraising. I think you're going to look back and
that ugly logo.
We talk about legacies and all of that.
An ugly stadium. Oh wait, they don't have one.
Danny White looking into that camera at the Peach Bowl and saying national champions. Those words have been worth millions.
Millions.
Couple of words, millions of dollars, and nothing they're doing over there in Tampa has captured the fan base, the alumni base, the student base, student population, the city, the region. Nothing has captured it. Mm-hmm. And
that's good. I love it.
It's both a blessing and a curse. It's good to have the sizable lead, probably for the better of the American, and maybe even UCF in some ways, a heated rivalry where two programs go head-to-head. In basketball with Houston and Cincinnati, head-to-head for the lead in the American, and one's going to win and one's going to lose, and you leave with a really good game. And you'd like to see it. Not that we don't lead in the Warren I-4, but you'd like to see
Warren
more competitive.
Like the Warren I-4 2017 football game. I mean, you know, they were still pretty decent at that point, and
You want to come out on that with a win.
One of us was going to win the American, one of it wasn't, you know?
And punches were thrown, and there's a victor, and there's someone standing. And they just do not find themselves now in that position. But fortunes can change, and, programs go up and go down. You see, a program like Tennessee used to have some glory. A Nebraska used to have some glory. And they're a long way away from those days. I'm not sure that the Cows have ever had glory, but they've had moments that they have failed to capitalize on, and I do think it goes back to that vision. So,
absolutely.
So a jokey question, but some serious question, and still want to beat them, but you'd like to see them, do something a little bit more competent from time to time,
Yep, there would be a much better rivalry. Thank you
for your questions,
absolutely.
One and all. Yep. Hashtag Ask Knightline. We answer your questions every week. You can throw them to us any day during the week, by the way. You don't have to wait till I've been putting out the call midweek just to start collecting questions.
I think it works a little bit better midweek.
When we're out of football season. So send them in.
And now, news and notes from the world of UCF sports.
Women's basketball picks up their 20th win. We've been talking about it at SMU Saturday, Knight 66, SMU 54. That's three consecutive 20-win seasons for the ladies, a first in the Division I era. UCF 9-1 in the American, 20-3 overall, with more to come.
Softball rebounds after dropping its first two games of the season against Ole Miss and Minnesota by beating Ohio State and George Mason. Sunday's game against North Florida was postponed because of rain. UCF is 2-2. Head coach Cindy Ball Malone picks up her first and second UCF wins and also wins number 100 and 101 as a head coach.
Track and field captures the 200-meter dash title at the Music City Challenge in Nashville. All told, the Knights posted six top 10 finishes, including four top five performances.
Men's tennis with their first win of the season, 4-3 at Indiana, but lost at Michigan on Sunday. The Knights are 1-5. Meantime, sophomore Gabriel DeCamps is the league's player of the week.
Women's tennis, the number 23 Knights, redshirt sophomore Valeria Zaliva is the American's player of the week. Meantime, the duo of Zaliva and her partner, Ksenia Kuznetsova, holy moly, are 6-0 and ranked 16th in the ITA Oracle rankings. Zaliva checks in at number 34 in the singles rankings.
Men's soccer alum Matthias Pizlo signs on with the professional Offenbacher Kickers in Germany.
Women's golf finishes 11th at the UCF Challenge.
And finally, women's basketball's 66-63 win over the Cows helped UCF pick up three more points in the War on I-4 rivalry. UCF leads the season-long series 30-6.
Pretty dominant performance, and the men get a chance on Wednesday night when the Cows come to UCF.
That was pretty good with those names there towards the end.
We never know if they're right. Somehow the reeds got shuffled. That was intended for you.
All right, this has been Knightline 180. I'm Andrew Phegley.
I'm Trace Trylko. Go Knights!
Charge on.
Victory is our cry, B-S-E-T-O-R-Y tonight.